Welcome to the Cybersecurity Speaker Series, presented by NSA's Cybersecurity Collaboration Center. Our mission is to augment and amplify NSA's ability to prevent and eradicate threats to national security systems and the defense industrial base by establishing open, robust, and collaborative relationships across industry and government. Through bidirectional threat intelligence sharing and joint analytic tradecraft development, these partnerships leverage unique talents and capabilities to enhance cybersecurity across the nation. In this series, you'll hear about the work we do here and its real-world applications, bringing these insights to you through some of the top minds at NSA.
Hi, my name is Bailey Bickley. I'm here at the NSA Cybersecurity Collaboration Center. And today we have something really exciting to talk about, at least I think so, post-quantum. It's real hot right now. But what many people might not know is that NSA actually makes all the keys, codes, and cryptography for our nation's most sensitive systems. We key millions of devices all over the planet, not only for US forces, but also for NATO and other allies. And we manage the infrastructure that can key those devices anytime and anywhere. So we know that cryptography is our first and last line of defense, but the eventuality of a post-quantum computer is coming. And so that's why I'm really excited to have two experts from our Keys and Codes organization here with me today to talk about our transition to post-quantum. So with that, I'll turn it over to them and let them introduce themselves.
Hi, I'm Adrian Stanger. I'm a subject matter expert in public key cryptography.
And I'm Bill Layton. I'm another subject matter expert working in cryptography and also implementations and some of the infrastructure and systems that were just mentioned.
And fun fact, I thought your name was Will for years, and I just found out it's Bill today. So bear with me while we recover from that. Okay, let's get started. We do try to reach a broad audience with these videos. So, you know, at a high level, can you explain what a quantum computer is, how far away it might be from development, and why anybody should care?
So a quantum computer could be a lot of different things to a lot of different people. The big notion is it's a computer that uses really weird physics that happens when things get really small and really cold. And in theory, if you make one of these things, it can solve some math problems regular computers can't. But there are lots of different kinds of them. If you hear on the news there are quantum computers, there are some that are limited in what they do. They can maybe solve some interesting problems. What interests us is that if you were to build a very large-scale one that was very reliable, it's still some distance into the future. If you got there, it could break an enormous share of all the cryptography that we use in the government, that people use at home to run the internet. Essentially, the foundation of security for a lot of the world would be shaken if we didn't do something about that.
Yeah, let me just add to that when we talk about cryptography here, we're talking about not just the effect of breaking encryption, but also the ability to masquerade as somebody, to break authentication, which has even bigger and more profound effects as that allows an adversary access to systems.
So you could not only break encryption of communications moving forward, but also all of those communications that might have been collected in the past. You can then gain access to those, masquerade, you know, undermine friend or foe, that type of thing.
Correct.
Sounds real bad.
You can authenticate the updates that people get to their systems, so all those software patches you get could be changed, or you could just masquerade as a website and steal people's web shopping. It's all the same system for everybody.
So how is NSA thinking about the threat, and, you know, how are we advising people to prepare? It doesn't feel imminent, but it doesn't feel that far away either. So, you know, where is NSA at in this space?
You know, that's one of the great challenges with cryptography. Unlike, say, a software vulnerability where the exploit might be just around the corner, with cryptography, we know that this is something that could be vulnerable in the future. But sometimes people don't see that future as needing imminent action. However, we've had a lot of experience with cryptographic transitions. They take a lot of time and energy. What we're recommending for people to do now, the most urgent things are to start to inventory, get a sense of how cryptography is used in their systems, and then start that planning process.
Yeah, I just add, If you're an end user of a computer, an IT system, any of these things, the hope is that essentially you just have to use some new mathematics that you never see. So your systems, your web browsers, your computers, your operating systems, they'll probably update themselves over the next few years and be in good time. The real challenge is for those who are managing systems, who are custom building things, for all those things out in the world that people forget to update or that have been carefully built and are rarely touched, getting through and finding all those places that need to be fixed over the next few years is really the big challenge that we're facing.
Well, it's interesting because you mentioned it's complex. And as I understand it, you know, first you have to update the math. Math is hard. And then there's the job of updating software. But then you also have to update hardware, right?
In some cases, yes. A lot of the hardware that's out there probably will be fine with the new algorithms. But there's updates of standards as well that needs to happen in there. We won't be boring you with the details of the math here, of course.
Oh, I think post-quantum is very interesting.
Oh, yeah. Well, I do, too. And so does Bill. But we're probably in a minority here.
Yeah, I think so.
But, yeah, needless to say, a lot of that work on the math side has been done. And we can talk maybe a little bit more about where that's going in standards and so forth. But that part's been done, and now we're looking at protocols and then implementations.
Yeah, just one detail to keep in mind, just a teeny bit technical. The nice part about the new mathematics we're using is it's actually easier to do than the math we've been using for 30 years. The research has come a long way. The only real problem we're having is that while the math is easier, it sends a little bit more data over the wire or the Wi-Fi or whatever you're using. And even that most of the time isn't a problem. It's just that the people who do the low-level network engineering work are having to make some changes. And there are standards groups already working that, engineering bodies. So for the vast majority of users, again, it'll be a fairly easy transition. It's not like you need a giant special computer just to protect yourself in the future.
Yeah, I do want to talk about standards. But before we go there, you know, you talk about this being easy for the end user, and that's great. But I don't know that I would call it easy for the U.S. government. You know, one of the things that struck me is, you know, the National Cybersecurity Strategy was recently released. And I was watching an event, and they talked about how the U.S. is leading the world in the transition to post-quantum cryptography, specifically with National Security Memorandum 10. So what is NSA's role in NSM-10? Are we driving that? Are we the implementers? And what exactly, for those that aren't familiar, can you share a little bit about what that is?
Sure. So NSM-10 was written by the National Security Council, signed off by the president, of course. And what it does is it directs the U.S. government transition to post-quantum cryptography, and it sets a deadline of 2035 for completion of that transition, which may sound like a long way off, but given how long cryptographic transitions usually take, that's actually not that much time. It does prescribe some actions to take now, in the long preparation and inventory, and kind of lays out a few of those steps along the way as well.
It might be worth adding, too, that many times when we talk about NSM-10, we talk about it as a national security object, but it's a directive to the government as a whole. So it's not just for defense systems or for super secret national security things. It's everything in the government, every system, every department, from, you know, weapon systems to your taxes to health records, the whole community.
And so then NSA's role, as I understand it, would be to drive that transition for, you know, national security systems, which are essentially, you know, systems that handle classified information or are otherwise important to, you know, military or intelligence, and then kind of just help advise the community as we go along. Here's how we're approaching it. You know, you might benefit as well.
You got it.
Okay. Yep. So you can't talk about quantum without talking about quantum key distribution, or QKD. You know, I know there's a large community that's, you know, working this, selling this kind of as a solution. And I know recently NSA published guidance on QKD in terms of national security systems. So how is NSA thinking about that and advising our customers on it?
So QKD, as you alluded to, it's a quantum capability. It has some unique security propositions that it offers. That capability is something that we don't espouse, but we think that it is pretty cool research that's out there, and we do foresee a day when That or similar technology can be at the heart of some systems that may be used in real world applications. I would say the biggest issue we have is that for us, we see these algorithms, the post-quantum cryptography, as something that you can deploy in boxes that are everywhere today, right, on your computer today. Whereas with QKD, you'd have to get specialized equipment, and it would be very expensive to do.
I have to say, QKD is one of the niftiest science experiments out there. If I was presenting to a physics class, this would be the thing I'd talk about, because you can lay it out on a board, you can show nifty experiments you can do with equipment and lasers, and it sounds useful. It's just that in real life, when you get to the stage of actually deploying this for real security, it turns out that doesn't provide you the services you need and requires a lot of expensive changes that aren't really required.
Gotcha. Okay, so cool science, still a ways to go to be matured. Okay. We've talked about NSM-10 setting timelines that are still a decade away. But NSA is preparing now, the community is preparing now. Have you had any challenges creating a sense of urgency for something that is still, a bit a ways away?
So I would say there's always a little bit of that issue when it's not something that's, here in present danger, so to speak. However, I would say that the release of the NSM-10 has helped with that, having basically the president's signature on "thou shalt do this."
Yeah, that helps.
Kind of makes a difference.
It's an interesting twist, I'd say also. Sometimes you're in urgency, and sometimes it's the other way around. There's another part of NSM-10 that says, thou shalt not deploy things until the standards are built and plans are done, because there are also those who want to deploy an experimental idea or grab a draft version of something. Part of the message is, this is important, but it's not something you want to solve this week. It's something you want to solve when the plans are built. Be organized about this. Come up with an agreed upon strategy for everyone so that we interoperate and we don't have to go back and fix the solution we just deployed again as we move along.
Yeah, it's kind of fascinating because depending on who we're speaking with, sometimes we have to describe it as this Goldilocks problem, right? But as Bill just described, right? Not too soon, not too late. And other times, other people that we brief, we kind of have to be pushing them, you got to go, because the processes are so slow in some cases. That go is really the only way forward.
It's needed. So, to that end, in terms of all the downstream implications, let's go back to standards. How is NSA working with standards organizations to prepare for this?
NSA does set standards for national security systems, but that's a small set of the systems out in the world. We want to interoperate with others. The basic mathematics problem that's been solved was run through a NIST. It's the National Institute of Standards and Technologies. They brought together a broad community, NSA was one of the commenters, but academics, different organizations all around, to establish the mathematics. From there, as they're finishing writing up the actual guidance for how to do the math, then other standards groups, the groups that deal with the internet, that deal with Wi-Fi, for NSA, we deal with some weapons system standards. Various other international standards bodies around the world are going to incorporate that into different communications protocols. And NSA engages in those in different places because, we have needs, other groups have needs, and we all need to cooperate to figure out how to best incorporate this into the new solutions.
Well, and to put it more plainly, I think you're saying, the average user, the average home user might have a different use case than NSA, who is supporting the warfighter on the battlefield with a radio in their hand. And so we need to be involved in that conversation so all of those use cases are considered.
Right. Yeah, the standards for web browsers are not quite the same as the standards for satellites, which are not quite the same as for radios running around on the battlefield. But they're surprisingly similar, and we all start in the same place to solve most of those problems.
Awesome. So I think, as we start to wrap this up, so NSA is contributing to standards bodies. We're driving this transition across the national security community. What would your call to action be for, not only the national security community, but business leaders and those that we might not have, direct authority over, but that might benefit from the way that we're approaching this problem?
So NSM-10 actually has a timeline, which I think makes sense for everybody. So it essentially says right now, because we can't deploy solutions, the things you need to do are find the things you're going to need to fix, because cryptography is hiding out everywhere now. Almost every piece of equipment you have has cryptography hidden inside it, and we've never really been good as a security community at finding all of those. And then also start the planning for those organizations that have to do budgets, they have to do updates, they have to change policies, because those are actions you can do today. The actual deployment, though, is not going to happen for another year, 2 years, 3 years as the standards propagate through and the products become available.
Yeah, I would say that that is basically the call to action. Plan and prepare now, do that inventory, and get those budget processes and other logistics underway so that when those standards are available, you can deploy them. Once we do have standardized products, at that point, you're definitely not thinking about the Goldilocks problem. You're definitely thinking about the go, 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 get it done.
Okay, so I hear don't panic, but plan and prepare starting now.
Yep.
Awesome. Okay. Well, thank you both for joining me today. I really appreciate your time.
Thank you, Bailey.
Oh, gosh, you're welcome. If you're interested to learn more about NSA's approach to post-quantum, our stance on QKD, FAQs, we have a website available on nsa.gov. You can go nsa.gov/cybersecurity and access all of our resources there. You can also follow us on Twitter at NSA Cyber. Thanks.